Serve to everyone. Now, the parasha of Vayakil basically reviews for us the construction of the Mishkan. Truma, the Torah gave us the outline of how it was going to be built. And Vayakil describes how it was actually built. But the introduction to Vayakil is a parsha regarding Shabbat. And the Gemara in Shabbat sees significance in this because this became the method by which we are able to define what is Melechus Avodah regarding Shabbat. So say you're not allowed to do work on Shabbat, what is work? So it's obvious that, for instance, in a community that does not have an Eruv, so if you have a handkerchief in your pocket and you carry it from your house out into the public street, so that's work. But if in your own house you move your couch from one area to the other, that's not work. In terms of how we define work, we would say just the opposite. The carrying the handkerchief involves no effort, no expenditure of energy. Moving the couch is a great effort. So therefore, that should be work. But it isn't, because of the Torah's definition, the halachic definition of what melocha is. So the Gemara in Shabbos derives all 39 ovos melochos. There are 39 categories of work. And then there are tolodos, which are subcategories. Derives it all from the Melechus HaMishkan, from what was done in the Mishkan. So whatever was done for the Mishkan is considered work for Shabbos. Whatever was not done for the Mishkan is not considered work for Shabbos. And because of that, therefore, the Gemara looks very carefully at every verse and every word that exists regarding the construction of the Mishkan. So it says in the Torah, Lo sase kol melocha. What does kol melocha mean? All work. So it's conceivable that there are two definitions. Kol melocha can mean all types of work. In other words, there are 39 types. And I forbid all 39 to you. Or kol melocha can mean the 39 together. The Torah only said, like, don't build a Mishkan on Shabbos. But that the individual melochas, if I do 1/39th of it, I didn't do anything. So on that, the Gemara quotes the pasuk that we have in this week's parsha. Lo savaru esh b'chol moshvaseichem b'yom haShabbat. You shall not light a fire in all of your encampments, wherever you are, on Shabbat. Why did the Torah single out that particular melocha? Could say, don't build on Shabbat. Don't sow on Shabbat. Don't plow, don't harvest, all the other melochas. So the Gemara discusses this, and there are two opinions in the Gemara. One is, Havora lechalek yotzos. the Torah wanted to emphasize that losasa kol malocha doesn't mean all 39 malochas. You cannot do any one of the malochas. So the Torah took one malocha, lo savaru esh b'chol mashmaseichem b'yom ha-shabbos, and the Torah specified that. And from that we learned that you can't do any other of the individual 38 other malochas either. Why did the Torah choose esh? Choose fire? So there are many comments on this. But one of the main comments is that Aish is the basic building block of all human civilization, technological progress. Chazal say that in the famous Medrash that Olam Rishon on Motzoi Shabbat somehow created Aish. The beginning of civilization, of the construction, was the ability to make fire. And therefore, since it is the basic malacha, it's, so to speak, the father and mother of all other technological malachas. So therefore, the Torah chose it to be the example of malacha, that you cannot make an eish on Shabbos. You can't make an eish on Shabbos. So then, l'chalek yotzos, we know that the Torah means to tell us that each of the individual 39 malachas is forbidden as well. The second opinion in the Gemara is havor l'lav yotzos. And making an eish on Shabbos is only a lav, it's not chorus. The other malachas on Shabbos, so if it's done b'mezid and b'hasro'o, so it's a chiyuv miso, b'chalaleo mos yumos. If it's done without eders or with an improper hasro'o, but the man did it b'mezid, so he's not chayiv miso, but it's chorus, chorus b'dei shamayim. Havora is neither miso nor chorus, according to this opinion. It's havora l'lav yotzos. The havora only came to tell us that it's a din of a lav. So a lav is chayiv malkus, a lav is osur, but it's not miso, it's not chorus. The Or Sameach or Meir Simcha in his commentary to the Gemara, to the Rambam. So he says that even the one that holds the lav yotzos will also hold that Eish is chayiv miso also because mechalaleo mos yumos. He violated the mechalaleo. But in any event, the Gemara discusses that it's only the lav yotzos. Now, so how do we understand this? So in the time of the Tzedokim, if you realize that when we come to this subject, that without Torah Shebaal Peh, it's impossible to determine what's going on at all. So at the time of the Tzedokim and later of the Karoim, so the Karoim said, Lo Savaru Eish B'chol Mashvasechem B'yom HaShabbos, means that you cannot have any fire burn on Shabbos. So therefore, in the houses of the Karaites, there was no fire, there was no warm food. There was no heating, there was no light, because there could be no fire. Chazal interpreted it differently. Mm-hmm. The Yisur is on you to make it. But if it's there somehow, by whatever means, that it's possible to light it before Shabbos, etc. So there's no Isser at all. And because of that, therefore, Chazal instituted a mandatory custom amongst the Jewish people that on Shabbat daytime, one has to eat chamim. One has to eat warm food. So whether it's tribe of Israel has its own type of warm food. In Eastern Europe, well, we called it chomes, right? It was potatoes, barley, meat, whatever. And that became incumbent as part of the process of Shabbos, that one has to have warm food. Chazal say, Lahotzi milibon shel tzedokim, in order to show that we're not like the tzedokim. And because that over the ages, there have been all sorts of methods used to have fire on Shabbos. And in our time, it has become great technological problems exist even today because fire on Shabbos is also attached to the question of bishul on Shabbos, cooking on Shabbos, warming on Shabbos. So what if you have automatic warming, which they have today? The oven will go on by itself. How do we view that? And then the question of clocks and timers that turn on and off. All of these questions are based only on the simple halachic principle that fire is permitted, you're not allowed to make it. And that that is included in the idea of why the Torah included lo sevaru esh b'chol mashmaseichem, because that's like the basic malacha. It's something that's necessary for Shabbos. You have to have a fire. Whereas none of the other 38 malachas do you necessarily require on that day for any particular purpose. So in our time, the question of electricity arose in the 1800s. What is electricity? That's a good question. The scientists haven't answered it yet. There are different opinions, different theories. It's pretty much not definable. It's electrons, it's a stream, what is it? So there were those that poskim who originally thought that electricity was Aish. Because it has the same properties, so to speak, to produce heat and warmth, et cetera, that's Aish. And based on that, therefore, there were many that said that on Yom Tov, you could turn on electricity. Because on Yom Tov, there's no Isser of Eish. You're allowed to cook on Yom Tov. And in the early 1900s, this was discussed widely in the Jewish world. There's a famous tshuva from the Aruch HaShulchan, from Yechiel Michal HaLevi Epstein. It appeared in the Torah Journal and reprinted here in America. So there was a long period of time in America, I remember as a child yet, that there were very observant Jews that turned on the lights on Yom Tov, because they said electricity was Aish. However, it became clear that electricity is not H. So the Chazon Ish came up with his understanding of the Isser, that it was Bonet completing the circuit. So it's like building, constructing. And that is the origin of why electric appliances, electricity can't be used, can't be turned on the Shabbat. Shlomo Zalman Auerbach disagreed with them both. He came closest to what the scientists say, that it's a stream. So it's not Bone, and it's not Eish, but it's in the halacha, there's a term called Makeh Bepatish. Makeh Bepatish is to complete something. To hit it with the hammer. The hammer used to have, mark of the artisan in it. So when you hit it, then it was done. It was marked. So it was the completion of a process. And on that also, there are all sorts of questions back and forth. So it's the certain degree an unanswered question as to what the Isser of electricity is. Different opinions. There's a question here in Israel arose that the electric company works on Shabbos, and it has Jews that are working on Shabbos. So how can you benefit? You can't benefit on Shabbos from melacha that's done on Shabbos for you. And Rav Herzig dealt with that problem. The basic heter is because there are hospitals. There are cholim. The cholim require electricity. Once there is a cholet, it requires electricity in the city. So when they make the electricity, so then everybody can benefit from it too. That's the basic heter that exists here in Israel for the use of electricity on Shabbos. It's been refined and made more exact. And as the technology has advanced, there are almost no human beings that work in the electrical corporation where the electricity is generated. The electric company fixes the wires, but where it's generated is almost all completely automatic today without human beings. So then that's another area to look at that perhaps makes it easier for Shabbos, etc. But there are many observant Jews that they don't use the electricity on Shabbos. They use private generators or batteries. I think there are thousands of such homes here in Israel that rely on that for Shabbos and don't rely on the Chevrat HaChashmal. So as the technology advances, it becomes more complicated. So for instance, solar energy, Dud Shemesh, can you have hot water on Shabbos? Well, if it's warmed by the sun, so Rav Avadya has a whole long tshuva to be matir it, explaining it. So if it ever gets to the case where electricity will be generated by solar or wind or all the other magical powers that they want to install, so then this shaila will disappear. And this is all part of the technological revolution of this past century, which is reflected in halacha over and over again. So we see from a simple posuk of Lo Tzavaru Eish B'chol Moshav Seichem ramifications which affect our weekly lives, certainly go to determine for us what type of Shabbat we should have. Rabbi Hananya ben Akashi Omer, what's up, Kodesh Baruch Hu, Lezakos Es Yisrael, Lefichach Hirbo Lahem Torah Mitzvot Shenemar, Adonai Chafetz Aman.